Please join us for the flag.
To the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Tonight we're going to start with the oath of office. Welcome everybody here tonight.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Board. Thank you very much for allowing us to take part in this evening. Tonight, we would like to welcome Ryan Hickey to the Hampton Fire Department. Mr. Hickey comes to us from Derry Fire Rescue, and we're proud to have him. We'll be joined by his family, and Ms. Casey Brown will be pinning him on after the swearing in. Yeah?
Okay. From the town of Hampton, in the county of Rockingham, to Ryan Hickey of Derry, New Hampshire, in the county of Rockingham. Whereas there is a vacancy in the office of firefighter in said town, and whereas we, the subscribers, have confidence in your ability and integrity to perform the duties of said office, we do hereby appoint you, the said Ryan Hickey, as firefighter of said town. And upon your taking the oath of office, and having the appointment and the certificate of said oath of office recorded by the town clerk, you shall have the powers, perform the duties, and be subject to the liabilities of such office until another person shall be chosen and qualified in your stead. Given under my hand this 15th day of June 2015, Fred Welch, Town Manager. Raise your right hand, repeat after me. I, Ryan Hickey.
I, Ryan Hickey.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
Discharge and perform.
Discharge and perform.
All the duties incumbent upon me.
All the duties incumbent upon me.
As a firefighter.
As a firefighter.
According to the best of my abilities.
According to the best of my abilities.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Of this Constitution.
Of this Constitution.
And the laws of the state of New Hampshire.
And the laws of the state of New Hampshire.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Ms. Casey Brown, if you'd come forward. Thank you, family. You wouldn't mind joining us, please.
Not too painful, then?
No.
Do the rounds.
Congratulations and welcome.
Yep.
Thank you.
Welcome, Ryan.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
My pleasure. Really, my pleasure. And I'm going to step right on up.
No photo bottle.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir.
We have the pleasurable duty this evening of swearing in a new fire chief. This doesn't happen very often. I've been in municipal government for 53 years, and I've only done it four times. So you can see it doesn't happen too often in time. Jamie Ayotte has been with us for, gosh, it's that many years, huh?
Three whole ones.
He started out as our deputy chief, and since late last year, about September time, he was appointed acting chief of the fire department. I had the pleasure of appointing him just recently, a couple of days ago, as the chief of the fire department. So he is beginning a new career in time, and hopefully he'll surpass my seniority in time with town government. And he's been a very active and a very steady person in the administration of the fire department. We're very proud of him. And we're proud to offer him for our fire chief. And if the town clerk would do the pleasure of swearing him in,
absolutely.
I will step aside.
With pleasure. From the town of Hampton in the county of Rockingham to Jameson Ayotte of Salisbury, Massachusetts in the county of Essex. Whereas there is a vacancy in the office of fire chief in said town, and whereas we, the subscribers, have confidence in your ability and integrity to perform the duties of said office, we do hereby appoint you, the said Jameson Ayotte, as fire chief of said town. And upon your taking the oath of office, and having this appointment and the certificate of said oath of office recorded by the town clerk, You shall have the powers, perform the duties, and be subject to the liabilities of such office until another person shall be chosen and qualified in your stead. Given under my hand this 15th day of June 2015, Fred Welch, Town Manager. Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, Jameson Ayotte.
I, Jameson Ayotte.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
Discharge and perform.
Discharge and perform.
All the duties incumbent upon me.
All the duties incumbent upon me.
As Fire Chief.
As Fire Chief.
According to the best of my abilities.
According to the best of my abilities.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Of this Constitution.
Of this Constitution.
And the laws of the State of New Hampshire.
And the laws of the State of New Hampshire.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Let's get your boss up here.
I could ask my wife Molly to join me and my three sons.
Hi. My three sons.
They're so cute. All right.
Ow.
Did it right.
My wife had a birthday yesterday. You can't see the hole. You have to do this again?
No.
We're proud of you. Congratulations.
Speech.
I'm overwhelmed by the support here tonight, and I'm sure Ryan feels the same way. My family and my family. Thank you all for coming out. We certainly do appreciate it. I think with Desi's permission, we're going to celebrate a little bit tonight. Mr. Man in the back. And this has been quite a long journey, and it wouldn't be possible without all of you. Thank you very much.
For the indulgence.
Thank you.
Have a great night.
Two beautiful
Have a good
families
time.
In one evening.
I agree.
Take a 5 minute break.
Because we have so many things on.
I'll take that to get them out of here.
We're going to have a little celebration.
Don't mosey.
As my family exits, if you don't mind, as you can see, I have a small. We're just going to take one shot, all right?
That's so cute. Oh, boy, that's so cute.
Welcome aboard. Everybody say hi, Max.
Want me to send that to you?
Thank you. Hi, Chief.
How you doing?
Can you have us out of here by 8, Craig?
8:10.
We're going to be moving on to public comment. Anyone that wishes for public comment who could join us at the podium. You'd like to join us up here, feel free.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. I'll maybe wait till the room clears out.
Trying to keep it going so your entourage won't have to wait so long.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. You invited public comment. I don't know if tonight's evening is more of a business meeting or if it's a public hearing. I don't have anything that's specifically on the agenda, but I'm just appearing to follow up on the May 18th public discussion on the selectmen's regulations on seawalls, revetments, and stairways. It's my understanding that the matter would be discussed this evening, and
we're going to give you a copy of it so you can take a look at it.
That's perfect, and so I can't really comment on anything at this point.
Okay. Any other public comment this evening? Please join us.
Gary Pohl, 4 Lyon Street. I'd just like to let you guys know I had 3 calls today telling me that I was in trouble with the IRS. They were going to start a lawsuit against me to call a New York number. The scam is starting to happen in Hampton, so I want everybody to please be aware of this. And if the IRS wants any kind of information, they're going to write you a letter. I've had a few of those before, but that's neither here nor there. Just everybody, please be careful. Thank you.
Did you tell the chief, too, that you're getting these calls?
I've told the WMUR, and I called Concord.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you for doing that. And any other public comment? Announcements in community? Are you going to join us, Skip?
Skip Webb, 28 Seabury Condominiums. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, distinguished selectmen. I'm coming forward to you tonight because the James House is going for a LCHIP grant, and on that grant there's points that are spelled out, and those points, oh wait a minute, this goes down. Am I on the agenda?
Yeah, you are on the agenda. Yeah.
Excuse me.
Okay, any other comment, public comment? Moving on to announcements. Mr. Waddell?
Oh, thank you. I go first. All right. I'd just like to say this was really a nice ceremony having the chief here and congratulate the chief on being sworn in. And, you know, it's a tribute to him and a tribute to the department of how smoothly they've run over this last year with a little bit of turmoil there. So I think everybody did a great job, and they all deserve a real good congratulations.
The sand sculptures are starting this week. I know they got a little
wet start today, but they did start with part of it. But I guess they start the competition on Thursday.
Wow.
So if you get a chance towards the end of the week to get down and see the sand sculptures at the beach, I'm sure you won't be disappointed.
Mr. Bean?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, thank you. I'd like to thank Mr. Welch for his service during my tenure, and especially during this last year, where myriad department heads, both the Alpha Command and the Bravo XO Command, have transitioned. And he has stayed the course, he has led magnificently, and he has billeted some incredible people, to include the Assistant Town Manager transitioning from HP to actual. So, outstanding work, Mr. Welch, and thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes, I just want to say that I am very disappointed that Mr. Warburton was not able to get an appointment with this board to celebrate Mr. Arthur Moody's 80 years as a Hampton resident. I just thought it was very sad. If any resident or taxpayer asks for an appointment, I think it should be granted. If it's some big complicated
thing. Is this an announcement?
Yes.
If not, take it up on old business. Do you have anything to announce? Would you like to wish Arthur a happy birthday?
I already have,
okay,
Mr. Chairman.
Great. Thank you.
The other item that I'm going to bring up later on relates to goals for the board.
I would like to let people know that the Hampton Beach Area Commission is coordinating and co-hosting an event with the New Hampshire State Parks next Monday, June 22nd at 9 a.m., celebrating the completion of the North Beach Seawall. The location will be at the end of the wall next to the park restrooms. This will be a ribbon-cutting ceremony with a special twist. The Hampton Historical Society will be providing a brief presentation on the history of the Hampton Seawall prior to the ribbon-cutting event. We have invited the governor and Senator Stiles, along with other local and state elected officials. Everybody's welcome to attend. And I would like to congratulate Chief Ayotte also. He's done a wonderful job, and I think everyone was afraid he didn't have the experience, but he has proved himself to be well experienced. And if we have such a talent now, it's only going to get better as time goes on. Thank you. The consent agenda. First is entertainment license and posted permits for the Casino Ballroom, Wally's Pub, the Goat Bar and Grill, Ocean Dining, doing business as Bernie's Bar and Grill, the Community Oven at 845 Lafayette Road. Next is parade and public gathering license for the Hampton Beach Catamaran Regatta, Kids Run the World 5K, Hampton Historical Society Pig Roast, Children's Festival Parade, which is the one that's every year at the that the Chamber does. Three are dance hall permits: the Casino Ballroom, Wally's Pub, the Water's Edge Yacht Club, Casino Mini Golf, Mac Restaurant Group, doing business as the Greatest Karaoke Bar, a raffle permit for the Hampton Historical Society. Five is licensed coin-operated amusement devices, which is Best Western, DM Sales Corp, which is on Ocean Boulevard. And six is request of no objection for outdoor service of alcohol, the taco room beverage wine license. Does anyone have any?
I'll make a motion that we approve the consent calendar.
I'll second that.
I have one question regarding the consent agenda. Up under entertainment licenses, B, Wally's Pub, does anyone
would
know?
Would you like to read that letter that came?
I'm just going to ask whether the parking lot area of Wally's has been resolved.
I can't answer the question because it's under the planning board's jurisdiction.
Okay.
And I'm not responsible for the inspection, so I haven't looked myself personally.
I'll ask Jason.
Okay.
Thank you.
And there was one letter of objection. Did everybody see that?
Yes, I did.
From Mrs. Toomey from the Harris Sea Ranch.
Right.
Does and just putting that out there.
Okay.
Does someone have a motion?
Yeah, I made a motion.
And
I seconded.
Any, all those in favor? Unanimous. Next, we have approval of minutes for June 1st, 2015.
Motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. The next, the sealed minutes for June 1st, 2015.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. The June 5th, 2015 minutes.
Also moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. And the the June 5th, 2015 sealed minutes.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Appointments. First, we have Bob Casasa, town moderator, and Jane Seifer, town clerk. Of our election.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members of the board, town manager, appreciate you affording me a few moments this evening. The town clerk, she was here earlier, had to leave. I just want to get out for sort of public discussion. 2016, we have four election events. Where they're held by statute is determined by the selectmen. The statute states that the selectmen of each town shall provide for a suitable place. And the companion statute says that every polling place in which elections are held shall be easily accessible to all persons. The four events in 2016, there'll be a presidential primary. The only date that I've seen associated with that so far is February 9th. That's one of the parties, one of the national parties selected that date. That could change, probably will change in the past couple cycles. It's been conducted in January. Then we have our town election, and we have a primary in September and November. In the past, we've held those September and November elections at Marston School. I don't think that location, in my opinion, from my experience, and I've shared this with some of you individually, is a suitable location for an election in November, a presidential election in November. I think it could still handle a September primary, but I don't think it's capable of handling the November 2016 election. The numbers, I know Mr. Waddell, Mr. Bean, your selectman representatives to the planning board. I think if you were sitting on the planning board and a business came to you and said, have about 4,000, maybe 5,000 cars who are going to visit my site parking, well, there's 75 parking spaces there, but it's shared with another business, and you know, that's what I propose. I don't think it would be warmly received by the planning board, and yet that's what we have at Marston School. So where to put it? I was talking to the principal at Winnicott High School this afternoon. I asked him what is his planning time if he were to try to put that into his 16-17 calendar. And it's really now. It's this summer. It's September. The SAU Joint Board votes on the calendar for 16-17. So if that's of interest to this board, an expression of that needs to be done in the next couple of months. Another thing I'd ask you to consider is whether Hampton is ready for more than one voting location. Certainly makes my job more difficult, but that's not the point of my job. It's going to make the town clerk's job more difficult, the supervisor's, the checklist job more difficult, but hopefully it makes for more suitable locations and more accessible locations. Where would the multiple locations be? I've thought about municipal buildings first, because most of those come with parking. They're mostly up to date from an accessibility standpoint, and typically they don't cost us any money. So those are considerations. But those buildings typically are used for other purposes, and you need to get on their schedules as well. So if we go back to 2008, which I think is probably most comparable for what we can expect in 2016, we just have numbers that I don't think can be accommodated at Marston School. The numbers for the presidential primary, people who cast votes over 6,000, for that general election over 8,000. Mm-hmm. And we have been verbally chastised, if you will, by representatives of the Attorney General's office on some recent elections at Marston where there's been difficulty getting to the site and getting parking. So looking for some direction, obviously not this evening, but I think it's something that we need to address sooner than later. Last point, warrant article in March of 2016. If it's appropriate, if it's necessary, do you need that for multiple voting locations? Do you want to use it as a poll, if you will? Would Hampton like to vote at more than one location? I know the deadline for that type of warrant article is a long time in the future, but it's something that you may work on as we go through this process. So again, thank you for your time this evening. What happens in January or February of 2016? It's very difficult to work with any organization because that date can change literally a couple weeks ahead of time. But if you reflect back to this past winter with all the snow and think about that Marston parking lot and trying to drive 6,000 people through there, I don't think that will work. Winneconne has been very good to us in giving us the location in March. The folks at the Hampton School District have been great to work with as well, so it's not anything about who we are working with. It's the physical locations of what we have to work with. And the goal for us is always get the most people as possible. We don't come anywhere near tapping the majority of our registered voters. We'd like to do that. I don't want location to be a reason for people not to exercise their right to vote.
Questions? Mr. Bridle.
Yeah, Bob, the reason we do it in March at the high school is because usually the warrant is so big and the ballot is so big because of that. Isn't that the...
It's turning the parking spaces, whereas if you're coming in to vote a one-page item, you get in and out of your parking space pretty quickly.
Right.
In March, it's a longer ballot, but it takes a little more reflection, or a little more reading, and we found that the parking spaces don't turn as quickly, and we needed more, and Winneconne has been able to accommodate that. You may recall we tried it at the gymnasium one time, and the sentiment was people weren't, you know, all that favorably impressed by that, but the dining hall seems to be has been better received.
And as you just said, and I want to reiterate that, so the public knows, is we really should start looking at two polling places just because the amount of space we have at each one of our public buildings is smaller. And so if we were at two polling places, you'd be able to have more accessibility.
And this is a question for the town manager, not that he's going to know this answer off the top of his head, and maybe for town council. Do you have to divide the town into wards in order to do that? Can you do it alphabetically? I've never heard or seen of a town that does it alphabetically, so I'm presuming there's got to be some ward structure that goes along with it. Is the town interested in that for really one day of, or more, or 4 days of voting? Those are all issues to ruminate on. But as we can see from the people who are visiting our state right now, January, February 2016 will be here before we know it.
Absolutely.
And I'd like to be prepared to offer up the best options for voters in Hampton for that election.
Mrs. Wolseley?
I'm not in favor of two polling places. I think it's too much of a nuisance, especially with the low voter turnout in non-federal elections, but I do agree that Winneconne, I think, would be great. We ought to book it on for next March and November and September if you need to for the primary.
Yeah. In talking to the principal, I think I can say this, but I defer that were on the calendar, on their calendar for March 8th, 2016, but I've never broached, and it's very difficult to say, can you get us in sometime in January and February? Oh, by the way, cancel school that day, too. They take advantage of March 8th by scheduling other activities. I have not asked them about September or November 2016 either.
Those are probably going to be the critical dates, because you're going to have more turning out for the federal election.
Certainly in November. Yeah. Historically, yeah. It's the highest number, yeah. Is a presidential general right. election is the highest number.
And I agree
number.
With you on when to come up for that, absolutely. But I'm not in favor of two or more polling places yet. I don't think we're ready for that.
Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Mr. Moderator, and thanks for the great work you always do, both at town meeting and at the elections. It's a lot of work, and you and the town clerk do very well. Thank you for your incipient, sagacious counsel at this very early stage for what will be high demand functions from the town clerk yourself. And I would simply defer to the town clerk, to Mr. Welch, and to yourself for a course of action going forward. Thank you.
And thank you very much. When we go first, I forget you. Mr. Waddell.
Well, thanks for being proactive on this, because having stood down there at Marston for the last few years holding signs all day long, you just stand there and cringe that somebody's going to be going to get hit by a car or have an accident yeah. down there. It's a disaster.
Yeah.
And we really need to do something else with our elections. And I think all your ideas are great, and I agree with Selectman Bean that you and the town clerk and the town manager should start working on this, and I'm sure the selectman will support whatever you come up with.
Yeah.
Thanks for your work.
And I agree with what Mr. Waddell said. Hopefully it's all going to go smooth. It seems like it always does, and we're looking forward to that continuing. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Skip, you want to join us at the table?
Sorry for my early introduction. One of my responsibilities as president of the James House is to periodically remind the public through the Board of Selectmen the arrangement between the Campbell family, the James House Association, and the town. It is a confusing relationship, and the reason why it's important that we come before you periodically and explain is because it's very easy for people to feel that the James House is actually a public museum operated by a public corporation. If you go to the state, it is that. But if you look at the deed, it isn't. We are really stewards of the property. We might be stewards for the property for its indemnity. We might be stewards of the property just until tomorrow. We can't sell the property, we can't rent the property, we can't change the use of the property. We have to operate it as a living history museum for the public, providing free education in James family history, in Hampton history, in archaeology, early period architecture, subsurface surveying, agriculture, and the social and economic influences that affected the James family and the people in Hampton from 1702 to 1940. The arrangement is that if we fail in doing those things in any way, the association dissolves and we offer the responsibilities to the Hampton Historic Society. If the Hampton Historic Society declines or accepts and then decides in the future that they don't want to do it anymore, or that they fail, it automatically refers to the town as the final owner, and the town is required to operate the James House as a living history museum. And the reason for that is that just the Campbell family wanted to make sure that the museum remained intact for as long as the building can stand. That being said, the other responsibility I have is to come before you periodically when there is ever a significant advance or a significant decline in the management, operation, and presentation of both restoration and the educational programs. We've had a lot of advancement the last year, a lot planned for this year. The West Gable last year had siding put on it. Next week, restored windows will be put into the West Gable. The front of the building will be restored this summer. And we hope to, with volunteer help, paint the back of the building, that part that faces the road, the L portion, and the west gable, the original red color that it originally was. We'll be painting the well house that red color and the shed that red color. We're hoping to be able to, the following year, finish the east side and put siding in the little L portion. That will add a handicap door and ramp. That will add handicap access to the building, just the first floor, but at least they'll be able to get into it. And we'll finish the outside restoration. We also recently laid, and some of you have been in that building recently, and we had an observation deck. People were afraid to finish the tour because they were afraid to go across the observation deck. It was a group of white shutters laid across over the supports. And they creaked, and one of them broke. So we have removed that. We have replaced and put down the old floors again in that room and also in the back room. In the back L, we have put down restored flooring. I wish the whole building could have flooring that looks that way, but we can't restore it to the rules of the Secretary of the Interior and have it look that way, but it is beautiful. Now, the real reason for me to pick this day to be here is that we found out at the beginning of the month that LCHIP was floating another LCHIP round of grants. It's a hard thing to do. They only give us 1 month to prepare the grant, and it ends up to be a book about so thick. I'm halfway through it. But in that is a very important section that requires, well, adds extra points for endorsement from elected officials and for discussing the problem with the selectmen. Now, I've assessed some of it already with you in my fire explanation. what we are going to be doing with the grant. The grant will be paying for what we did last year, what we're going to do this year, and what is planned to do the following year. And LCHIP would be paying half. We will be having a match for the half. But because we have financed the west gable and the front of the house, we already have paid them the money for one-third of that restoration. We have the money for the rest of it, and still keeping $10,000 aside, so if anything happens to the property, we have that for protection, and also it covers the $2,000 to $3,000 that our programs provide. I didn't mention in the first part the education programs. LifePass Live program is still living strong. It's been going for 10 years. We're offering a whole bunch of lectures on historic plays to organizations that would like to hear them. All they have to do is call me and I will send somebody out to give you a lecture or a play. Free of charge. Free education. We have sent out, and it's a new program, it's based on the school program that was in Hampton and Northampton that we had for 10 years. That was teacher based. And when those teachers retired, and they also switched curriculum, this is where it was taught, the program collapsed. We have put that program together and enhanced it heavily so that we can go to other schools and give lectures in the classrooms as well as the schools coming to the James House for a visit in all of those pieces of education that I listed earlier. Again, a new free education program that has been offered to 210 schools located in Massachusetts, Maine, and mainly Seacoast, New Hampshire. We have a new program, Junior Director Program. Any of you people that are listening, that are graduating from the academy, and going into the high school, or in the high school, you are invited to join our junior director program. You will sit with our full directors at the board meetings. You will participate in all plans related to the organization. You will get a full education as to how to run a nonprofit and the trials and tribulations that go along with it. You will help run all of the events, and if you are having the attributes, you will be asked to give lectures and plays. Now, what I'm asking is that we have your endorsement as far as backing for the LCHIP grant so that we can get those extra points.
Why don't we start a conversation with the board about that?
Okay.
Mr. Waddell.
Yeah, I mean, I'm in support of
that. Are there any questions, too, on what I've asked? Yeah, because this all pertains to the same thing.
Yeah, that's what we're going to...
I think you've done a great explanation of what goes on there, Skip, and the programs you offer and stuff like that. Applying for the grant, is there any cost to the town or any matching or anything, or is it a straight grant?
No, a matter of fact, in that arrangement that I was making with the town, the association is supposed to be trying to do the restoration and the education pieces, if possible, and if possible, is in big quotes. It doesn't mean that we are excluded from going and asking you to create a warrant article that would be expense to the town. But we are supposed to try to do it without expense to the town. And that is one reason why the project goes so slowly, because it is done with donations, mainly, and a few fundraisers. And the membership is spread out all over the country. It's not just people that are here in Hampton.
I support it.
Thank you. Mr. Bridle.
No, as one of your neighbors up there, I see the work that goes on there all summer long. And Mr. Webb, you ought to be commended for the work that you do there. Personally, I see your car there, if not every day, many days, from this time of year all summer long. You do spend a tremendous amount of time, and that building shows. And I think we should be behind you, support you, whatever we can to help you get this grant, and I'm in full support of that.
Thank you very much, and I want to thank you for the work that you've given us, too. You helped take down a couple of trees there for us, which were not easy to take down, and you removed all of the branches. If you notice, I got somebody to take down two trees recently. They didn't remove the branches.
Well, maybe we'll have to do that again.
This is a good time to remember your wife, Elizabeth, too. What a wonderful job she always did over there with you and supporting both of you, supporting the James House. Mrs. Wolseley.
Yes, you have great work, Skip, over the years, and I have no problem supporting the application. Do you have a format for the motion, Mr. Manager, on how should we phrase it?
I think just simply that the Board of Selectmen supports the program.
Supports the LCHIP grant application?
Right. Yep.
Because I'd be happy to make that.
Yeah, motion. They don't accept letters of endorsement.
Yeah.
They just have us list
right. The
elected officials that have endorsed.
If we have that on our record, then...
So if you have that on the record tonight, that suffices.
Someone want to second her motion?
I will second that.
We have a second. Mr. Bean.
Mr. Webb, an enthusiastic endorsement of your efforts and all of you that participate up there. Thank you very much. And, of course, we support your effort here tonight. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Now, in conclusion, and I invite you to the open house at the James House on the 27th of this month. It's a Saturday. We're going to be giving tours starting at 10 o'clock. We're going to have weaving demonstrations at 12 o'clock. Lunch will go to 1 o'clock. The annual meeting will be at 1 o'clock, but it will start with the paranormals giving spirit chasers paranormals from Northampton. They're going to give the how they did their research and the results of the research. We're going to have a family reunion.
Huh? Don't forget the pie sales.
Okay.
The pie contest.
Well, that's not on the opening day, though. On July 17th, we are having the James family reunion. And on September 27th, on a Sunday, we're having the apple pie blueberry cook-off.
Okay, now you're talking.
We're going to have three bands with entertainment out there. We're going to have clowns. We're going to have people walking around with raffles. You name it, it's going to be out there.
Well, it's people like you that make Hampton a nice place to live, and we appreciate that you came in tonight.
Well, thank you very much for your time. Thank you for the endorsement. And let's all keep our fingers crossed that we get that grant.
Okay, great. Thank you, Skip.
Rusty, I didn't realize you lived in such a lively neighborhood.
Oh.
Next, we have Peter Sari joining us at the table.
When you have a tractor and a dump trailer that everybody loves.
Good thing. There we are.
Good evening.
Peter Sari. I have Mary Gans with me because she has some background also representing Mrs. Silva. And I don't know how much background information the board has or wants. I can go through in detail or I can skim over it, whichever you prefer.
Your memo is before them, Peter, the one from earlier this month.
Well, then I'll leave it
June
to
9.
I'll leave it to you to ask any questions you like then, because that's a summary. I do have more detail if you want to, but that summarizes
the situation. Does anyone feel that they need more information on this memo? Nope. Okay, questions. Mr. Bridle.
No, I'm all set.
Mrs. Wolseley?
As long as our counsel and you are comfortable, I don't have a problem with
Mr. Bean?
What you're resolving.
I've reviewed the documents, reviewed the prepared motion, and am very satisfied that we don't need a detailed brief.
And Mr. Waddell?
Same thing. The memo is pretty explicit, and it just looks like a problem that needs to be cleared up, and I'm all for it.
And Mr. Gerald?
Yes, I commend the both of you for working through this. It was a long-standing problem, and it's now going to be corrected, so there can be a closing on the property soon, I expect.
Yes, excellent. Thank you.
And I'll commend you, Mark, for hanging in there so long. It took a while, and it's a lot of effort on your part, too.
Yep, just add the word approve and sign. The word sign.
So. All right. I will make the motion that we hereby move to approve and sign the boundary line agreement presented by Attorney Sari to correct the title problems with lot 65 and to fix the boundary line for the easterly boundary, which shall be recorded without expense to the town.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next we have Joe Coronati, Woodland Road.
Question. Good evening. We were here before the board a little while ago. We've made some changes to the plans at the request of the board. We've also been to the planning board to eliminate a couple of the conditions that were brought up as a concern. The conditions were the salt, not being allowed to use any salt on the road, as well as moving the observation wells that we agreed to put in to assist with Aquarian's effort of monitoring the groundwater. We moved those out of the right-of-way, and in order for them to be on private property, we've also added easements to those for the lots that they reside on. We have the easements are shown on our A1 plan, which is the subdivision plat, and the and we've also added some notes that the town manager asked us to add in about conduits for street lights, and tonight we're here for, I guess, approval of basically everything: the hydrants, the street lights, the location of the monitoring wells. I believe we're on the agenda for the road improvements, but we've already, or for the bonding, but we've already received, I believe, approval for the bond amount from your board, and we're also here for the sewer easement, which would be granted to the town for our cross-country sewer line.
Did you want to say something, Mr. Welch?
All this has been worked out, Mr. Chairman, and it's all in the plans. It's been finished. It should be approved by the board.
It should be approved by the board?
It meets your requirements. It meets the requirements of the planning board. I didn't realize you have to go back to the planning board, but it meets all the requirements of the ordinance.
I make a motion that we accept it.
Do we want to open this?
I second that motion.
Okay, we have a first and we have a second. Mr. Bridle, any comments?
No, it appears that they've come up with everything that we've asked them to, so.
Mrs. Wolseley.
On A1, number 22, the town of Hampton shall clean only the catch basins within the roadway, and only after the road is accepted as a Class 5 highway. Any catch basins, drain manholes, and connected piping outside of the road right-of-way shall become the property of the Homeowners Association. The drainage easements will become the property of the Homeowners Association, while the sewer easements will become the property of the town of Hampton. This is assuming that this
road development is accepted as a Class 5 highway.
That's correct.
I have no intention of voting to approve it.
Mr. Bean?
I have no comments.
All those in favor? All those
I'm opposed.
4-1. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We also have a, I don't know, we have a sewer easement that it could sign by the selectmen. And Peter, sorry, has drafted the document up. And Bob actually has his wife on the way. She's the manager for RK Dalla to sign it, to try to save one step. If you're willing to look at it tonight and sign it tonight, it would save possibly either another meeting or at least another item that the board has to take care of. But
yes, that document's acceptable. I have a final one that added the selectman's signatures as accepting this document.
All right.
All we need is this document to sign the first part, and then they can sign the rest.
All right. So I think he'll stay here tonight. His wife will be here any minute now, and she can sign that. And and that could be one more finalized item.
We're done.
Nice. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have another follow up or
not?
Well, we have listed on here a discussion of hydrants, discussion of streetlights, discussion of proposed bonding for the road improvements, and then the sewer easement. Are we tackling those one by one, or is it a given that this plan contains everything that's appropriate? I know you have great concerns, Mr. Welch, on streetlights. And
well, the streetlight concerns that we voiced to the developer have been corrected. They have
on here.
Yes, they have indicated on both the utility plan and the regular plan that the street lighting connections will be in conduit, so should the wiring fail, they can simply be backpulled, new wiring put in, rather than having to dig up the entire subdivision to find out where things are.
But that will be the responsibility of the homeowners association?
That will be the it'll be the responsibility of the utility company as to where the wiring is.
Right.
Okay. The light is our responsibility. The street light is part of the subdivision of public improvement, but the wiring is utility company.
Okay.
And one of the reasons we had suggested the conduit is simply because there was a distance between the power source and the street light, and digging up that entire area is just unnecessary.
But if the conduit wire needs to be replaced in the conduit at some point in time, the homeowners association will be answerable to the utility. They'll pay that bill. The town will not have to.
It'll be between the homeowners association and the utility company.
Okay.
Yes.
And what about the hydrants?
The hydrants were approved previously by the board, and there is one hydrant in the subdivision.
Okay.
And should the road become a public highway, then that will be paid for by the town.
Okay.
This is all yet to be installed, of course.
Okay.
And the bonding and road improvements has been approved by the planning board. They have the final cost on that.
Mm-hmm.
And they will be approving that when they return to the planning board if there's any change in it from what was originally approved. The sewer easement you have with council.
Yeah. So the bonding, the planning board will take care of the holding the bond until the improvements are done and the construction.
They'll solicit the bond. The bond will be held by the selectmen.
Oh, okay. Okay. Thank you.
You have to discharge it once you once the road is completed and inspected, and with the planning board's concurrence.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Thank you.
So
thank you very
we
much.
We need a motion to have the selectmen accept and sign the sewer easement deed. Did I miss
don't
that?
We have to, I thought you said no. We had to sign it for.
Yes, it'll be signed. Mrs. Dockham is coming along.
Right. You do need that motion.
Yes.
Okay.
We're waiting for you to intervene.
Mr. Waddell and Mr. Bridle seconded.
Make that motion that we accept the sewer easement.
All those in favor, 4 and 1 against. And we're prepared to sign it.
Thank so after she gets there, I'll have her sign and bring it up. Is that?
Oh, it's here for
protocol?
Them to sign.
Oh. Oh, okay.
She can then sign.
Sign that one. Okay.
So we should sign it now?
Afterwards. She isn't here.
Okay. Moving on to the town manager's report. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board. There will be a meeting of the Rockingham County Commissioners at 6 p.m. on July 16, 2015, to which the selectmen are invited to discuss the county budget. An RSVP is requested by the county commissioners. The county jail provided inmates to clean the Church Street parking lot. The work was accomplished on Tuesday, June 9th, and the service was exceptional. And I will add to that that I have talked to the chief since, and they are coming back to deal with additional cleaning work in the community, and we're trying to schedule them each week for different things. They're going to be cleaning the back of the town hall where all that overgrown brush is, which would be make that look much better out there.
They did the Phragmites several years ago.
They did, and they did a wonderful job, and we're going to end up cutting those back again as well. I want to express my appreciation to Patty McKenzie for supplying documents from her records, her personal records, regarding the seawall construction on the North Beach. Our records were destroyed when the old town hall was flooded, and she's provided a very valuable service to both the town and her neighbors by providing those documents. It was a great, great help. And I'd like to request that the board appoint Jamie Sullivan as the acting town manager during my absence from June 16th through June 21st, 2015. I'd also like to make a note that, and I believe you have it, I provided it to you today in your handouts, which you received this evening. I received the schedule for the use of the state park by various organizations through the fall. That came today.
Do we need a motion for Jamie?
By statute, yes, sir.
Okay, someone want to make that?
I'll make the motion. We have Jamie as the acting town manager from June 16th to the 21st.
I'll second that.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Questions for the town manager's report? Mr. Bridle.
Yes, it's good to see that the jail sent those people over. A couple places we might want to look at is the area of Drakeside Road and Toll Farm Road. That corner there is grown up with the sumac and stuff that's there.
Yep.
Both sides of the road there, and it's really starting to encroach over the road, over the bridge, over 95.
That's good.
And that might be a good area to do. Also, look at the area down by, on Drakeside Road, I saw the area down by where Drake's River comes underneath. There's some of that stuff along the sides of the road there, too, that could use some.
At several locations like that, yeah.
Yeah, so, but that'd be great jobs for them, and I did see the town parking lot down there, and it did look very nice.
It's much, much cleaner.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mrs. Wellesley.
Fred, the letter from the lady on one of our town motels, is the building inspector going to be taking a look at that? Or
already inspected it, and they're in the it wasn't as bad as depicted, but it was bad. It
sounded pretty awful.
Well, it did. It wasn't quite that bad when they arrived. They did do an inspection.
Oh.
They are going back early this week to complete the final inspection. It is being cleaned, and they have every feeling that the work will be done correctly and the building will be at top-notch condition.
So the owners have a heads up now that somebody's looking out.
The owner
out
is a
for
resident
them?
There, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
So as opposed to the previous time we had a problem where the owner was not a resident,
right,
and they had rented it out to someone to manage.
Flood letters.
Planning Department and the Conservation Commission.
They're doing the letters?
They're setting the entire process up. Jamie is reviewing it. I've given him all the documents that we've received from FEMA, including the flood maps that we've received from mm-hmm. FEMA. And he's reviewing those, and they're supposed to be reporting back to us.
Some of those places are going to need elevation certificates. And
anybody who questions their inclusion is going to need an elevation certificate.
The time frame is getting mighty close.
Yep.
We have any
September,
kind of
mid-September.
September 15th yep. is the drop dead date.
Right. Well, September 15th is the drop dead date to challenge being in the district, but it is not the drop dead date to do the survey. That's something
right,
that's perennial.
But if you don't have your flood policy in place prior to the 15th, You're gonna be grandfathered. You're gonna be preferred if you have the flood policy in place under the current flood regulations.
Our flood regulations are in place in the ordinance or voted on at the March town meeting.
Right, but you need to get your flood policy if you're gonna buy one you need to get it before the 15th, or you won't be grandfathered, and the price will be considerably higher.
No, you're talking about the actual insurance policy.
Right.
Yes. Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So I just I'm getting nervous,
right,
because I want to make sure that people have a chance to know that. River Avenue, any movement on that complaint? The person with the smelly fish stuff, et cetera?
My understanding is that that has been referred to the State Department of Public Health.
Okay, so
It may be a violation of the state public health rules.
Okay,
and the Department of Fish and Game as well.
Okay, but that's our leased land. Do we have any, are we waiting for those authorities to?
We are waiting for those authorities to give us their opinion and to indicate whether or not there is a violation present.
And then we can move if we need to as to what's appropriate on town leased land?
That's correct.
I just don't want it to fall through the cracks. Seabrook Station income, we had a memo in here that was talking about $8,000 a year, and I wasn't quite sure where they're coming from, but it looks...
That was from the State Department of Safety.
Yes.
And every year we have drills for
here
the Seabrook Station.
Yeah.
Those drills are paid for by funds that are allocated through the Department of Safety and the Department of Energy and the Seabrook Station. And the funds that were discussed there are to reimburse the town for any expenses or drills that we hold.
Mm-hmm. A flat rate of $8,500 annually paid on a quarterly basis to each community. So
that's correct.
So basically this, we have been getting that?
We have been getting
that. And this means we will continue to?
Yes, it does.
To get that. Well, that's good.
That's an order from the state that we have to receive it.
I'm glad the state had a little money left over.
It's not theirs. That's why they ordered it.
And after that, I'm all done.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Waddell?
I'm sure I know the answer to my question anyways, but just to reassure people, I mean, all these inmates that are doing the cleaning up, it's well supervised and everything else.
Oh, yes.
Absolutely.
Yes. There are members of the Sheriff's Department here and the jail. We also have our own personnel keeping an eye on things as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We assume no breakouts or anything like that?
These folks are all in there for short periods of time, and to break out, they'll be going to the prison in Concord, so they know that's not a question.
Thank you for your report.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman. Moving on to old business. Number one, confirmation of vote on non-union raises. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, the board requested that we go through and add 1.5% or selected that range. We have gone through and we have earmarked all the individuals who receive. We have adjusted everybody in accordance with those things that need to be prorated. We had one employee who has been promoted out of a department into another department, and there is a small amount of money there that represents the period from April 1st until the transfer.
Now, did everyone get a printout of the June 5th scale? Because we went, Fred and Christy and I went over it.
We did distribute this copy to everybody.
Yep. Right.
So,
because at the time, I would not call it so much a vote as a consensus on proceeding to get the paperwork done.
Yes.
On this. The cost for 39 weeks for this non-union wage schedule starting April 1st, 2015, is $13,136.61.
That's correct.
And I will so move that we grant the non-union raises to the personnel listed on the June 5th document.
I'll second that.
Okay. Did you have any comments, Mr. Bridle?
All set. I think they did a good job going through it.
Mrs. Wolseley, did you have any further comments?
No, I would just hope that this becomes automatic out of the finance office so that every year between the March election and April 1st, that the non-union individuals be so listed and whatever monies might be available.
In accordance with the board's instructions, that order has been already issued.
That's great.
How it goes every year, isn't it?
No, actually, yeah, up until now, it's waited until, by order of the board, it's waited until the board actually does something to cause it to happen. But your last discussion said it was to be automatic, mm-hmm, and we took that as gospel until you change it, and we have issued those orders.
Okay. We designated April 1st.
That's correct.
No comments on this issue, sir.
Okay. So all those in favor, unanimous.
Thank you.
Next, an update to the Hampton Code 805-45 speed limit established. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, we had noticed running through on the North Beach and the Main Beach streets and the questions that were raised at the various public hearings of the board held, and reviewing some of that material, we found some inaccuracies in the mm-hmm. in the current code. And this report that you have in front of you is to in fact correct those inaccuracies so that the code does in fact reflect what is actually out there. That's my report.
Okay. Questions, Mr. Brida?
No, I looked at it. Looks fine to me.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Yeah, it looks good to me, too.
Mr. Bean?
I looked at it fine.
Okay, so you just need a consensus that everything's fine there?
Actually, you need a vote, sir, because you need to change that. We need to change that ordinance and to be in compliance with.
I'll make a motion that we update code 805-45 speed limit established.
I'll second.
To the list that was provided.
Cardle and Mrs. Wolseley seconds.
Yeah.
All those in favor, unanimous. Number three, confirmation of postponement of fee increase for fireworks display for the precinct.
Mr. Chairman, some months ago you changed, after a public hearing, you changed the proposed fees that were operated on by the fire department in 2015. In changing those fees, we were not aware of the fact that the precinct has a three-year contract. They are in the third year of that contract. There is no, that is for the fireworks for the year. There is no provision in that contract for them to pay the fees. There's nothing in their budget. So what we're asking you to do is for this year to waive those fees and to come back to the board before the beginning of the following year and discuss the matter with the precinct commissioners and to see what the precinct commissioners do believe should happen and what you believe should happen, and then take a new vote.
And what do you think that time frame would be on that?
I would suggest that we do that prior to November so that, in fact, for things after January 1st, so that we have some time to take care of any changes that need to be put into place.
Okay, so we'll do that like after the Seafood Festival sometime.
Yes, absolutely.
In there. That will be a better time for everybody. So any discussion of this? Mr. Bridle?
Nope, I have no problem with it. I think it being fair to them, allow them to put them on notice that it is coming now, and they need to come in and talk with us again September, October of this year. But I think we give the postponement of this until next year.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Yeah, I'm not happy with waiving fees, but in this case, as long as we catch it before next year,
correct,
and go ahead and get the precinct on track, then I don't have a problem. Did you get a second?
I didn't make a motion, but I can.
Well, we probably should have.
All right, I'll make a motion that we have a postponement of the fee increase for the fireworks display for the precinct.
For 2015 only. I'll second Rusty.
Okay. Mr. Bean, did you have any comments?
Negative, sir.
And Mr. Wardell?
No, I go along with the postponement this year and then open it for discussion next year, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I've already talked to them, and they're planning on coming in sometime in the fall.
That's fine.
So all those in favor, unanimous. They have some other ways of looking at it than what's been discussed here at the board, so they're looking forward to coming in and talking about it.
Good.
Any other old business? Mrs. Wolseley.
Union contracts. Has there been a response to the most recent letter from the Hampton Police Union asking for negotiations to be set up?
I think you need to discuss that after this meeting because you need to discuss how you're going to do that.
So we have not officially done a response?
No, that's my knowledge, and it's not in my purview to do the response anyhow. So.
No, I realize that, but I'm just wondering if a letter of acknowledgement had
run out. I haven't seen it.
Okay. And then, wait one second here. Are we going to set up on our calendar, on our agendas, the goals? We got the memo from Jamie Sullivan April 30th, and we were going to go over all our goals for this year, which is faster disappearing. We're going to have that on a subsequent agenda?
Yes, ma'am, you were.
Okay. Tempus fugit, you know.
Any other old business?
Wait a minute, I'm still running through quickly here. Oh, that's a new one. Just briefly, Rick and I were at the meeting on the Hampton Beach
Area Commission.
Revamping the master plan, and it was interesting the ideas that the public came up with that evening, and we broke into groups to identify some of the big needs. But my group, Fred Rice and I, and some of the commissioners, we were the only ones who targeted the bridge, and I, as far as I'm concerned, that's the most desperate need down there. The state representatives did not want to hear that they own the sidewalks, by the way, Fred. So it was an interesting, I thought it was an interesting evening and good input from the individuals present. So we'll see whether they get the grant.
Yeah, I think everyone, and it was brought up from many sides about the ownership of the sidewalks, and people are looking forward to having a discussion about the ownership of the sidewalks.
One of the things I would suggest they do is they look at the recordings in the Registry of Deeds, that in fact, when the area around Mrs. Mitchell's was redone, uh-huh, and it had to be surveyed, and it clearly shows those sidewalks are owned by the state of New Hampshire.
Well, I think, for one thing, part of the discussion is that the sidewalks might be quite different than they are today. So I think if there's possibilities that the smaller sidewalks had some ownership, the new ones are going to be probably three times larger. So there's a lot to be discussed here.
It's part of the layout of the road.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah. There's a lot to be discussed. Any other old business?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Oh. If I may, yeah, briefly, as you know, the Budget Committee meets tomorrow evening. You stepped up to represent your board, Mr. Chairman, with the stepping down of another board member this spring. And I just want to review the two meetings that have occurred, the agenda, and then solicit input from you for tomorrow evening. I understand that you'll be attending that meeting tomorrow. Is that correct?
I'll see if I have the time to go, but I will try
that's
to go.
That's what was my understanding from a conversation.
I'm glad to be there.
On April 21st, there was a meeting. I attended that meeting. I provided my report as the selectman's representative, mm-hmm, and left the meeting and fulfilled my knowledge of the agenda for the remaining part of that meeting. On Tuesday, May 19th, the New Hampshire Municipal Association provided their budget seminar, on demand, as it's called. It was simply an overview of the New Hampshire Municipal's budgeting laws. I'm a man that has a practice with my family members and legal contracts. I've read virtually all of New Hampshire's RSAs as it relates to the budget committees. I informed you and emailed the chair that I would not be attending that. I think that my brush up is adequate. Going forward for the 16 June meeting, there was a report from the selectman's representative. It specifically says budget impact only. Mr. Chair, if you would like to direct the board for any comments that you would like me to provide tomorrow evening, if you could go around, and there's a couple of other inputs I'd like.
Okay. Mr.
As far as budget inputs, is what do you...
Well, I'll read off the agenda from the chair, woman. Number 9, report from selectman representative, parentheses, budget impact only.
So
I take that to be this year.
This year's budget?
So far, yeah.
Well, we've got the report from the finance director on, yep, on where we're at and where we sit by the date she had on it, and I got it here someplace. So, I mean, that's basically where we're at.
use the recap.
We have the, you can talk about the storm damage. I think that coming up a little bit. So you can talk about what we're going to do with that. So
Christy has a recap.
Right. Right. So that's what I'm saying. That's the only thing really so far that you can give them from as far as I'm concerned.
Mr. Waddell?
Yeah, I think you've got the recap of what the finances are so far. But I think budget impact would be how it's impacting different departments. I mean, they might be living within the budget, but is it having an impact on their services and their delivery? And I think that is you know, something that can be worked through with the town manager maybe and getting more of an input to you, the selectman's representative, and probably not have that all together tomorrow night. But I think the important thing is, what's the impact been? I mean, you can have a budget and live within it.
What isn't getting done?
But what isn't getting done, and what is, you know, mm-hmm. how is it affecting the departments and stuff? And I think that's the important part, and I think that's what should come out of this. So I would, you know, say that that's something that would be ongoing working. The selectmen are, mm-hmm. are discussing with the town manager, with the department heads on how this is affecting them and what their departments.
Yeah.
Mrs. Wellesley?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, Christy's information is here, and then whatever else Phil, Fred can provide.
And do you have input, Mr. Chairman? That'll go to the town manager.
Again, Christy's given you a mm-hmm. well-drafted accounting there. And
okay. Thank you.
Pretty much that's where I stand.
Thank you. And Mr. Welch, do you have any input you would like me to provide tomorrow, specifically the storm and operational challenges as a result of the budget?
Yes, and I think we're going to get that under item number 5 under new business.
Okay, great. And please feel free, anyone, to email me tomorrow on anything you'd like me to share with the board.
Thank you. Great.
Thank you, sir.
Yes. Moving on to new business. Selectmen's regulation, seawalls, revetments, and stairs on town property. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I have sent you dated 5/2015 because that's the day we started working on it after the public hearing.
Can we have them sign that? She's here. I'm sorry. Before we started, I meant to.
Where is counsel? Where is the document?
Do you have the document with you?
I have a copy of the document. I thought Mark said you guys had the copy Mark that you wanted all signed.
Oh, Mark has it.
That's why I asked him to let us sign it when he was here.
Because I have a copy, but I don't know if that means anything or not.
It only requires one document to be signed. So if everybody signs it, that's the document we can record.
Okay.
And zip zap and away it's gone.
Sign it first, then I told her not to sign it because I thought you had
to. Okay. Do you used to drive a school bus?
Yes.
Same time as I did.
Long time ago.
You were a little student at the time.
No, I was one of the bus drivers.
That was a long time ago.
I know. I'm like, I know Rusty. So
he's hard to forget.
Thanks, Rick.
I think it's just one place.
All right, it's Mark.
Oh, here he is. Man of the hour.
Would you rather us have
your copy of this?
Oh, God. There.
He likes multiple copies.
You want that back or not?
It doesn't matter.
Thank you.
We're done.
Awesome.
That's it.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks for the interruption.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Sorry, Mr. Welch.
No. That was very important. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, you held a public hearing on this subject, and on 5/2015, in compliance with that public hearing, and the individual items that were represented there and the board's comments, We went back and reworked this entire selectman's set of regulations, and I believe we supplied a copy to each of you for review.
I'm not
basically
that.
This has been somewhat, shall I say, gutted. The current process is that the Conservation Commission issues a permit, the Planning Board holds a hearing and issues a permit. That comes to the selectman. At that point, you would issue a permit for a seawall or corrections to a seawall or a revetment or in the placement of stairs, etc. On the plan is approved by the other two boards. And the real meat and potatoes in this is the permit for the contractor to work on town property. Since that's been where most of our problems have occurred in the past, we left the requirements in that they have to come and get the necessary permits from the board to work on town property. They have to have the contractor have the necessary insurance. Once all of those requirements are taken care of, the selectman will issue a permit to have the seawall or revetment present. That permit is non-expirable. It will continue to function until such time as it needs to be replaced again, or major work needs to be done on it, in which case we're back here. We're getting the contractor to come and get a necessary permit to get on the town beach. We continue the restrictions between May 15th and September 15th, so there would be no interference with people using the beach. There will be no leases. This is a grant in perpetuity for the seawall to be there. It only needs to be renewed when it needs to be replaced. So that's, in a nutshell, that's what these regulations provide for. There are no fees. And I believe I've given you a motion. I think I handed out to each of you, a copy of it to each of you, which would be place this into effect. For those few places that, in fact, have leases, it would order the cancellation of those leases in accordance with law, and a refund of any fees that they paid the town for those leases.
Questions, Mr. Riddle?
So long as this corrects the fact so people can still get deeds and loans and stuff like that, I think it works out well. It allows them to get their property.
Won't interfere with anything on their property.
Perfect, and I'll make the motion that you just mentioned.
And I'll second that.
Further comments, Mrs. Wolseley?
What impact does this have on this? This will take effect regarding the current leases that we have with existing property owners on North Beach, right?
Or anywhere else, for that matter.
Well,
as long as it's for a revetment or
I think it's mostly at North Beach that we have the leases now.
Yeah, I think there's one someplace else, but I think that's it. Maybe Island Path.
Right. So when are we still going to go down the property line on the east? Per Mr. Tinker's suggestion, where we have encroachments on public land, et cetera, is this going to be applicable? I thought we'd have more of a discussion with council than just getting the printout.
The statute provides, and we're not talking about, we're talking about the assessment statute.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing I can do about that. That's a state law. And if you're on town property or if you're occupying town property, the law requires us to assess it and tax it.
Right. Now, I don't quite understand why or how we got into the leases to begin with.
That was something that came about 3 or 4 years
right,
ago.
Right, I remember. But yeah. I just hope that this clears everything up. So as we go down the road, down with the properties,
right,
there will be no leases, and everyone who either owns property or is this strictly the revetments?
This is strictly seawalls and revetments on town property.
Okay. So this has nothing to do with somebody having their patio on the town beach?
If it's on town property.
Comes under assessment.
It also comes under a permit.
Right.
If you're going to do something on town property, you will come to the selectman. They will give you a permit.
But this says seawalls, revetments, and stairs.
Right.
There's more stuff on town property.
As a portion of all that information that's on town property, all of it is the result of them building seawalls.
Well, there aren't seawalls on the South Beach.
Oh, yes, there are.
Where?
Oh, yeah. Along the whole riverfront and partly on the oceanfront.
Because I thought on the oceanfront it's mostly like Boston Ave and some of the others, just sand.
Well, that's not the South Beach. That's the main beach.
Well, okay.
Yeah. But
I see what you're saying.
That in itself
is nothing built there. So you're talking Sun Valley and the river.
Right. There's nothing built on the main beach.
Okay.
There are no walls there. There's nothing built there. So it doesn't affect them at all.
Okay.
In fact, we own the land in front of those properties on the South Beach.
Okay.
So
this saves us from leases. It saves us from insurance proof.
It saves us from insurance on the individual properties. It does not save the contractors from having insurance if they're going to do work.
Right. Okay. I just was a little puzzled. I thought we'd have a little more of a discussion on it because I know that is a hot button issue, but it was good that the people came in and discussed that.
Yes.
That was very valuable.
Excellent.
Mr. Chairman, you have a motion and a second. If I could just perhaps formalize that a bit more. It is strictly the Selectman's regulations for seawalls, revetments, and stairs on town property dated 20 May 2015.
Correct.
Thank you.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Moving on, the North Beach parking and other issues. Mr. Welch?
Mr. Chairman, as you know, you held a public meeting with residents from the North Beach area, and I appointed a committee composed of the deputy town manager, the chief of police, the acting fire chief at the time, and the public works director, and the town planner, and myself, and we went through each of the individual streets. We have issued a report to the board with regards to recommendations of what needs to happen on the North Beach area. We did some specific traffic regulations amendments and new traffic requirements for the North Beach so that, in fact, fire and police and ambulance equipment can get down through those streets at any time. We basically restricted parking on the numbered streets on one side only. And we actually had the police department and the fire department go down and actually take a look at each of those streets with public works and with planning and came back with a written recommendation as to which side of which streets would be no parking. They'd be fire lanes, tow zones, which is the way fire lanes are done in this town. We also provided for stop signs at each of the streets in that area, so they would be in the code. And there are some streets that have stop signs, there are some streets that do not. We also amended the fire lanes code for all the streets that are there, and our recommendations included working with the State Department of Transportation for pavement marking on Ocean Boulevard at each intersecting numbered street for no parking within 20 feet of the intersection. That includes signage, of course. Pavement marking for each of the numbered streets at its intersection with Ocean Boulevards and King Highway as no parking within 20 feet of the intersection. We've been doing that now for 2 years. We want to make sure it was in the regulation, so it would be part of that. The police department to hire traffic and ticketing enforcement personnel. The fines collected from parking violations to be deposited in a separate account to provide payments for parking enforcement. Code changes will be necessary to implement that. The department to paint, the Department of Public Works, to paint individual parking spaces on the numbered and other streets. That will not happen until next year, because it's so late in the season. The committee and town departments to continue monitoring changes approved to determine effectiveness. The selectmen to approve the appending code changes. The other thing that we wanted to do and we thought was important was that on the on King's Highway at the old pump station, which is no longer used, that we put two portable toilets there to stop this indiscriminate defecation of private property along along the streets in that area.
I'll put a sign by Rick's house that says, all old ladies go over there.
As long as you uphold the law, there won't be a problem.
Yeah, right. I hear you.
Let me read this, Mr. Welch.
Sir.
The North Beach recommendations. Work with the State Department of Transportation's to pavement mark Ocean Boulevard at each intersecting numbered street for no parking within 20 feet of each intersection.
Right.
Excellent.
Pavement number two, pavement mark each numbered street at its intersection with Ocean Boulevard and Kings Highway as no parking within 20 feet of the intersection. Three, place portable toilets at the sewer pumping station on Kings Highway from June 15th to September 15th. Four, the police department hire traffic and parking enforcement personnel. Five, the fines collected from parking violations to be deposited in a separate account to provide payments for parking enforcement. Code changes will be necessary to implement. Six, the department to paint individual parking spaces on numbered and othered streets. Seven, the committee and town departments to continue monitoring the changes approved to determine effectiveness. Eight, the selectmen to approve the appended code revisions. And on the traffic regulations, amend the code of Town of Hampton by adding at the end of the first sentence in section 805-2 the following new wording. Except a municipal vehicle or a contractor operating on town business for the maintenance and repair of the street or sidewalk, the repair and maintenance of sewers and drains, placement, removal, or repair of traffic controls and signs, the removal of solid waste, recycling waste, snow, ice, and other obstructions in the sweeping of the streets when authorized by lawful authority of the police department. Parking regulations. Amend the code of the Town of Hampton by adding a new definition to section 805-4 describing accessibility of driveways as follows. Accessibility to driveways. No person shall park, stop, stand, idle, or otherwise occupy any portion of a street within 2 feet of each either side of a town approved and permitted driveway. Stopping, standing, or parking prohibited in specific places. Amend the code of the Town of Hampton by adding the following new subsection to 805-11. Within 20 feet of all corners on all numbered streets from 1st to through 19th Street. And then there is a long list to amend the code for between 1st and 19th Street, Green Street, Gill Street, Kings Highway, Meadow Pond, Pearl Street, Redcoat Lane, and Redmond Lane. And pretty much for all of those, it says Fire Lane Tow Zone, no parking on the northerly side of the roadway for its entire length.
There are also a number on the southerly side.
Yes.
Yeah. It alternates depending on where existing facilities were in the street.
Yeah. And stop intersections. Amend the code of the Town of Hampton by adding the following section 805-32.
That's the stop signs at each one of the streets.
Yeah. It's all the same streets that we just mentioned, isn't it?
Right. It is.
And it's westerly before entering Kings Highway. And then for all 1 to 19 on Gill Street, easterly before entering Kings Highway. Also on Green Street, Redcoat Lane, Redmond Street. And then fire lanes, 1st through 16.
17, 18, 19 are already fire lanes.
Correct. And some of them are on the north side and some of them are on the south side. Green Street, both sides of the street for its entire length. Kings Highway, east side of the street for its entire length. Kings Highway, west side of the street from Winneconnet Road to the end of the paved sidewalk. Kings Highway, west side of the street from High Street, 200 feet southerly, and Meadow Pond Road, westerly side of the roadway for its entire length, and north and south ends of the street for their entire width. One of the things that I, so these are the North Beach recommendations.
Yes, sir.
So what exactly does that mean?
That means the board has the opportunity at this point to either implement or not implement those recommendations or to selectively remove individual recommendations. Okay.
Well, I think the one that I think needs to be looked at here are the porta potties. I don't feel that that's necessary. And so I'm going to throw that out there and see what everyone else thinks.
Good.
I have a feeling that the neighbors are not going to be happy about that. They'd rather have the people going in the woods, would be my guess, because no one wants porta potties. I'm hearing a lot of other talk of porta potties in other locations. I'm hearing a lot of people aren't happy about it. So I don't really can't imagine people on Kings Highway are going to be happy about those porta potties. So that, I think, should be part of our discussion. Mr. Bridle.
I don't necessarily like the idea of porta potties, but I also don't like the idea of people going on other people's property. I would hope that we can have some discussion with the state about a possibility of a bathroom down the area of Winnicunnet Road. That's a long stretch from the Ashworth to North Beach. And I think that there could be something done there eventually. It's not something that's going to happen right away. But I also understand the concerns of the people that live in that area about wanting to have porta potties there. And
well, this is at 12th Street.
Right, but it's at
mm-hmm.
that. It, we're talking this whole area.
I don't think we heard anyone say they wanted porta potties there. About
I didn't hear anything on porta potty wanting them. They just didn't like the people messing in there.
That's why I question. Can't they just put a sign up that says "No trespassing" or something like that?
You can, but you're going to have a police officer there to enforce it. It's a problem.
But could we have a couple of signs that let people know where the public bathrooms are?
Yeah,
they're still not going to.
I know they're not, but
we can ask the state to erect them because this is on state property.
Right. I mean, if they could have a couple along the front and just let people know where the closest bathroom is. I don't necessarily like the idea of, you know, what happens when porta potties, I know you can anchor them to the ground, I know they can, but I also know, unless they're kept very clean,
yeah,
it can be also.
They're a perennial problem to keep clean and to keep
Serviced,
yeah.
Correct. So I don't know, I'm not necessarily in favor of the porta potties at this time.
Okay. Mrs. Woolsey.
Well, I don't think it would hurt to try. We have no control over what a bear does in the woods, but we certainly should have some control over what human beings are doing. And we did bring up at the meeting that the beach held in May about the need somewhere over there for a state bathroom facility. I'm excited about the, the driveway stipulations, so people don't have tourist A blocking them out of their own driveway. Is the state going to get mad at us for painting no parking 20 feet from corner on their highway?
We have to receive permission from them to do that.
Oh, my. They'll probably charge us a fee. But this is great. Now, enforcement. You said that for the enforcement, the fees are going to come. We're going to get fees for. I'm just concerned about whether the chief would have money enough to hire. And don't they need special training, or we'll get sued, something like that? When you have
there is some training, but it's not the same as a police officer's.
Okay. Because
you're just writing a traffic citation.
So is this something that we're looking for the enforcement part for the individuals to do that? Are we looking for that, say, next year, or is that something you'd try to implement this year?
Actually, we're looking at implementing it this year.
Okay.
It's up to the chief if he has the personnel available to do that.
Okay.
We have quite a number of people who have applied to be special police officers, and they're in training.
Okay.
We may be able to use them.
Okay.
But it would require to set this. We have to go through council, but we'd have to have approval, I believe, from town meeting to set up this separate account.
Okay. But at least we'd get it started in the works.
Well, and that was the idea, was to start something so that hopefully this won't be an ongoing problem for year after year after year after year. As people get used to what's happening here, the number of citations will go down substantially, we think.
Yeah.
The word will spread and people will just obey the law as it's written.
This is long overdue. I'm awfully glad we had those hearings. I'm glad that so many people turned out, because I think that was very, very valuable. And I appreciate the work that went into this. So thank you, and the fire lanes and so forth. I think that's very well done.
Mr. Bean.
Yeah, great work. I have severe reservations about the temporary laboratories, if you will. I wouldn't want them in my neighborhood. I think they cause more problems than they solve. The state clearly has parking spots. They're paving up there this year that they could easily forego and put in a bathhouse at existing parking spots with sewer access.
Sewer is right there, immediately available.
It's the North Beach takes up a very small footprint. They have to go clear to Ashworth. So that's something that our legislators and perhaps town personnel can deal with. So the police department hiring traffic and parking enforcement personnel, I have some reservations about that. I don't think that's specific enough. I don't know what that entails in terms of, you know, to approve tonight. Is it part-time? Is it seasonal? That's a rather generic. And that's number four. And number five, the fines collected to be deposited to provide payments for parking enforcement. So I'd want a much more vigorous drill down on exactly what employment looks like. I think that is a good issue, and one that we should support, because if you have people down there enforcing parking, then there's a badge, and people are less likely to tend to Mother Nature's urges if there's a badge around. So while I support those, I don't think four and five are specific enough, and that three should be removed. So that's my comment, sir. Thank you.
Mr. Wardell.
I think it's a great job. I think we had the public in here. We listened to them. I think you put a committee together. The committee did some good work on this. I think it's a great start. I've got to agree with the portable laboratories. I don't think that's a good idea right now. I think we should, if the people come back and say we'd like that, then we could do it. But I don't think that's going to happen, as Rick said. So I don't think that's a good idea, unless, I don't know if you've been to one of these events where they have those real fancy ones, you know, that are almost like a trailer, and they're almost like a regular one.
$1,500
a day,
like
that, they're very expensive. Which could happen. I think the portable parties probably would cause problems, because they're just so difficult to keep clean and keep up. But I think this is really, really a great start, and I think you listen to the people, you put the committee together, you put these recommendations together. It's a really good idea, and I think we should keep going forward with it. And some things are going to work, some things aren't. And let's do it, but let's maybe forget the porta potties.
Yeah. And how, you know, what does everyone think about them putting a no trespassing sign there at that area, at that pump station?
Nobody will pay any attention at all.
Well, maybe you won't, but maybe other people will.
I'm
when I see a sign that says no trespassing, I don't trespass.
I know that. But you
okay, so I guess you're just a lawbreaker.
I mean, if that's legal, you could do it. What's going to hurt doing it? It's small and it's...
First of all, the police can't enforce it unless it has a no trespassing sign, according to what he said here.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. So that's what we need to do.
Okay.
From what
we
can
do that.
See. And what do we have to do to get this moving, Mr. Walsh?
Well, you obviously don't want item number three, so we're going to strike that.
Could I make one observation on the porta potties? Could we try for 1 month?
No.
Would it be worth?
How would you like them to park from your house?
Well, I don't live in that area, and I don't have people coming in and peeing in my yard.
Well, why don't we try it at your house for a month and see?
No, I don't live down there.
But I think a better idea would be if people, it's now out there public about the porta potties. If people came and said, you had enough neighbors come and said, put one there, please, then do it. Let's not put one there.
Anyone say they wanted one?
Or
yeah,
even
I don't think
on
so.
A trial basis.
Yeah.
I did hear the police say that we need no trespassing signs if we are going to arrest people for trespassing.
That is correct.
Okay.
So
good.
I think that's where we need to go.
And to start to implement these recommendations, it doesn't mean that they're all going to be done right away. And I agree with you, Phil, on the hiring of the personnel. We need to to find out just exactly what that means. Are we looking at some part-time? Now, I know we've had part-time parking enforcement before, and we probably still have that on the books down there. We just haven't filled it in the past couple of years because he's had issues with that. But I think it's important that we have some part-time parking enforcement, and I agree with Phil that if they see a badge down there, that's going to curb a lot of stuff too. And there's more other places in town they can be used for this parking, as we have a number of issues on the leaded streets, not just the numbered streets, and the west side of Ashworth Ave in the summertime. There's times that we can use parking, and along with the island. Boar's Head, we had other places up there, so I'm sure that we can use them. I like the idea of collecting the fees and using that to offset the cost of that. I think it's good. There are other parts of town when you have certain stuff, even uptown. I'm sure some of our uptown businesses would like to see some of the parking enforced up there, where there's two-hour parking uptown. Yep. And so if we have problems uptown, it could be used there. But I think we need to start to get that parking and traffic enforcement, and I think it's going to pay for itself. So with the exception of number three, I don't have any problems. Obviously, the fee collecting, number five, that's something that probably can't be done until next year at town meeting, but we could work on it now. So these are the recommendations to work on, so we can work on that for a warrant article or whatever it is, so that we can correct that. But other than that, I've got no problem with this list.
Yeah, and so, again, where do we have to go from here, Mr. Welch?
Mr. Chairman, first recommendation we'd make is to, in fact, amend the ordinance so these parking designations can go into effect, the fire lanes and tow zones on these various streets, so that we have room for our fire trucks and ambulances to get through. That's what's important in the summertime and all year round, because we have these problems continuously all year. Those should be implemented. The traffic control regulations for fire lanes, for stop signs, and for parking, along with prohibiting parking in front of driveways and within 2 feet of a driveway, which was one of the big complaints that we had here that night. That should be put into effect. Prohibiting the stopping, standing, or parking in prohibited spaces. That's an amendment to the existing ordinance that makes it more well-defined so that we understand what we're really doing.
Good.
And then you have the designation of one-way streets, which deals with the maintenance of those streets by town forces. And you can go the wrong way under certain situations with the permission of the police department or the Board of Selectmen. So those things were considered to be important in order to get the basic maintenance done and to keep the roads in good repair and to allow traffic to move properly on these various streets. And obviously we're not making these streets one way to speak of, because they're open to traffic in both directions. We just don't want parking on one side on most of these streets. Mm-hmm. So fire and police equipment can get down.
So I will make a motion to accept the recommendations for the traffic control, the designation of one-way streets, the parking regulations, the stopping, standing, and parking prohibited on specific places, the no parking areas, the stop intersections, and the fire lanes as presented.
I'll second Rusty.
And if you could just accept an amendment and to vigorously pursue items 1 through 8, yay or nay, on the North Beach recommendations.
So we get it all in one. Yeah, there you go. Very good.
Well, except for?
Except
for.
Wait,
and it's to pursue, but not to execute, just to look at those going forward.
Okay. So all those in favor? Unanimous. Yeah. I just wanted to say I went to a graduation party of someone in my family yesterday down in Chelmsford, and my cousin lives right in this area, has a house there for 40 years. He has never seen anyone go to the bathroom, and I tried to tell him this, and he was appalled that I have a feeling that whatever happened there was just very limited.
Well, I think putting in the no trespassing sign, that will give the police department some teeth to to correct whatever's there, and we can go.
Give a pause.
Give a pause, right.
So I think that would be good.
Okay.
Moving. That's a big load off our minds, I think.
Well, it was very good that we had those meetings and got that done.
South Beach area amendments to the no parking areas.
We kind of changed that designation. Everybody talked about the South Beach when we're talking about these things, north and south. It's really the west side streets of the main beach. We looked at those very carefully, and what we decided was, on looking at them and actually going down and trying to drive down the streets to see what was there, we would suggest that you amend Section 805-20, no parking areas, and 805-41, fire lanes, so that in compliance with a couple of requests for Stephen Hobson.
I'll read that,
okay.
Mr. Welch, so that people can hear it, because I notice they're pretty much that many of them are different. Hobson Avenue, no parking, fire zone, tow zone, and existing no parking area in the ordinance, and add the remaining portion on the south side of the roadway for its remaining length as a no parking, fire lane, tow zone. Manchester Street, add tow zone to current ordinance that forbids parking for the entire length of the street on both sides. Keith Avenue, add tow zone to current ordinance that forbids parking for the entire length of the street on the south side and include those restrictions in the hammerheads at the end of the street. Mooring Lane, add tow zones to current ordinance that forbids parking on either side of the roadway for its entire length from May 30th to September 1st. Auburn Avenue, add tow zone to existing ordinance that forbids parking on both sides of the roadway for its entire length as a fire lane. Perkins Avenue, add tow zone, fire lane to existing ordinance that forbids parking on the south side of the roadway for its entire length. Johnson Avenue, add tow zone, fire lane to the existing ordinance that requires no parking on the entire southerly side of the roadway for its entire length on the paved surface. Riverview Terrace, add tow zone, fire lane to the existing ordinance that requires no parking on the entire southerly side of the roadway for its entire length on the paved surface. Bragg Avenue, add tow zone, fire lane to the existing ordinance that requires no parking on the entire southerly side of the roadway for its entire length on the paved surface. Tuttle Avenue, add tow zone, fire lane to the existing ordinance that requires no parking on the northerly side of the roadway for its entire length on the paved surface. Fellows Ave, add tow zone to the existing ordinance that requires no parking of the north side of the roadway for its entire length on the paved surface. Harris Avenue, no changes recommended. Changing Harris Avenue to a one-way street is not recommended. Harris does not intersect with Fellows Avenue, but does so over a private boundary. It would be preferable to install speed tables on a seasonal basis to address the speed issue. Comments, Mr. Bridle?
No, I know most of these streets down there fairly well, and the ones they've picked to have no parking on either side, I agree with them, especially Manchester Street. Manchester Street is very, very narrow. Mm. I know the only one that wasn't mentioned on here was Dow, and Dow, I believe, already is a fire lane. So
it is.
But other than that, I got no problem with this. We got to make sure that we have access down there, and there's at times and you can't get through those streets down there because of the parking, so we have to address it.
Yep. Mrs. Woolsey?
I'll second Rusty's motion. That's a very good job getting that set up.
Mr. Bean?
No comment, sir.
Mr. Waddell?
All set.
Okay. All those in favor? Unanimous. So next we have DRA Form PA-28, Inventory of Taxable Property Form Not Used.
Mr. Chairman, there was, years ago, there used to be a statutory provision that said if the board voted in any year not to use PA-41, that from then on, or PA-28, excuse me, from then on it would not be used. It's the inventory form, and it would require an inventory form from everybody in town. If you didn't file one There would be a series of penalties, including tax penalties, et cetera, et cetera. But it would require us to file almost 10,000 of these forms somewhere in the town hall annually, and to go through each and every one of them for assessment purposes. It simply isn't worth it. It's a huge boondoggle. I don't know why it hasn't been repealed, but here it is, and annually we have to go through this proposition of saying whether or not we would do this. We would need additional help in order to carry this out. I don't recommend you do it.
Okay. Comments, Mr. Bridle?
Going by the town manager's thing, I recommend that we do not use the form DRA PA28.
Mrs. Second. Wellesley. Mr. Bean. Mr. Waddell. So do we need a motion?
I just did.
You do, yeah.
So we have a first and we have a second. All those in favor, unanimous. Withdrawal of funds from surplus to reimburse for winter storm expenses. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, we have sent the board a listing of the funds that were used, along with a copy of the statute that's involved, and a proposed draft letter to the Commissioner of Revenue Administration. The law provides that should funds be expended, and that they have already been expended, to take care of emergency situations, then the selectmen should apply, if necessary, to the Commissioner of Revenue for reimbursement of those funds through some means. And the only means that's really available is to take them from the unreserved fund balance. The total amount, and what we did here is we took 2013 as the test year, because that was a normal winter year in the spring, the January through March period. We wish it were spring this year. And we ran that against 2015, and the difference was $352,241.10 that was expended more than in 15 than was in 13. So we would ask that the board consider writing a letter to the Commissioner of Revenue asking for authority to remove $352,241 and put it back in the individual highway accounts. There were, of that sum, there was $3,612.70 that came from the police department for paid details on week 7, 8, and 11 of the payroll period.
So moved, $352,241 in a petition to DRA.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Yes. I'm opposed to doing this, gentlemen. I think it's too early in the year. I would like to see lines, and this is going to particularly apply to Public Works, most likely. I would like to see lines overexpended where we need to spend the money. I think in September or October, as we approach the tax rate setting date, don't forget, you've got in here $5 million in, let me pull this out. We've got over $5 million. It's in Fred's letter.
$5,455,000.
Yeah, $5,455,567. As designated as unreserved or surplus. I think the appropriate time to do that is see how we get through the summer, and then when we get to probably early October, take a look, see where we are, and then see whether we still need to, and we probably will at that point in time, go ahead. But I think this is way too early. I think this is jumping the gun.
Okay.
And we don't have all the revenues in yet either that we'll have by the fall.
And so you're recommending that we do that, though, Mr. Welch. Would you like to respond to that?
I am recommending. I understand the situation. While we have $5 million in surplus, when I look at the budget for the highway division where this money came from, mm-hmm. And we'll just let's just do snow and ice, which is our wintertime maintenance account.
Yeah.
Okay. This money came out of there, and the total amount of appropriation in that account was considerably less. It was only $160,000 for the entire year. As it stands right now, without specific authority from the selectmen to overspend individual line items within the budget, I'm going to be forced to cut money, $352,000 out of that budget now, because I don't have it. It's gone. It's gone, and I don't know. There's a lot of I either have to take the money from the sewer division, which I can't do, or the wastewater division, or I have to take it from the transfer station, and I don't have any money to spare in either one of those. The nice thing about this is that if you don't spend the money after putting it back in, then it goes back to surplus automatically, and you'd still have money available there. You have filed, or we have filed with the federal government, with FEMA, a request for reimbursement, but it's only for 2 days because the governor did not declare the entire 2.5 month period as an emergency. Mm-hmm. So we'll be lucky if we receive $75,000 or $100,000 out of all that money that we spent. All the rest of it's just going to sit out there. At some point in time, the rubber's going to meet the road, as they say, because we're going to end up with programs that we have to cut now because we don't have the money. If I spend it and the board doesn't approve it later, we're in serious trouble.
Okay. Let's let Mr. Wardell comment.
Yeah. So if we did this now, Fred.
Sure.
And then we got the federal money.
Federal money goes to revenue. It doesn't come back to the department.
Okay.
We don't see any of that money.
All right.
So that will be a revenue that will, if it causes us to exceed the amount of revenues we projected, that money will automatically fall to surplus.
Okay. Sorry.
But we don't get a chance to put that back in the
okay.
budget.
Okay. So that would fall back to surplus. If we don't do this now, what you're saying is this is money that has been spent already.
Correct.
Correct. So you're going to have to move it from some other line item to here.
No, actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to shut down programs.
Right, because you don't have it to.
That's correct. I'm going to shut down $352,000 worth of programs.
Okay.
And I'm probably going to be coming back to the Board of Selectmen to find out which days you want the transfer station closed, when you don't want Christmas tree pickup anymore, you don't want leaf pickup anymore. Those things are all incidental to normal operations. Any work on sidewalks that we have scheduled will be canceled. We're prepared to start working in all those areas as we go through the year. For instance, we have work that's going to go on Exeter Road, which is a warrant article, thank goodness. But we also have some work on Main Street or Lafayette Road here in town, where we have some severe problems with sidewalks. And we've had a number of injuries there from falling that we need to do some work. I'm going to have to curtail that entire account. That's only $25,000.
And you haven't seen anything until you see what happens when you close the transfer station.
Right, and the fact of the matter is that this is not something that was overspent. This is something that had to be spent. This was something that, the winter caused and stuff. So yeah, okay.
I don't want to do any of those things.
Yeah, I've got my answer.
Mr. Bridle?
I have my answer, too, I think. I understand what Mary Louise is saying, if we try to find $350,000 out of the other budget, any of the projects that go on during the summer, road pavings, sidewalks, patching holes, the work on the sides of the roads, as you've talked about,
the shoulders
and stuff like that,
true.
We don't have any money because we can't wait till November to do that. We have to do that now, and the town can't wait to see what we have in November to then all of a sudden go say, oh, well, we can do this little bit. We can't do that. You can't wait that long. So I think it's prudent that we do this now. I think the people want to see the work continue in town, this was something that was totally unpredictable. We could not predict that we were going to have this much snow. We couldn't predict this, and I think we need to move forward. That the unspecified funds or unreserved fund, they sometimes they're called the rainy day fund. Well, mm-hmm. It was pouring. It was pouring in February and March, and I think now we have to address that. So.
Just so you know where we stand financially in the town right now, we currently have underspent our budget by $324,600, mm-hmm. Or thereabouts. according to the finance division. 368,000, excuse me. We're under target that much. But that means taking money from every single department in the town to make up for the deficit in one department. So I'm going to have to, you know, to play the game of not renewing now, not putting money back in where it was expended and would normally have been expended. And I've already made allowances for the cost was way over $400,000, but I've already made allowances for what was spent in 2013 and deducted that from the amount of money spent. If we don't do that now, then I can't tell you where we're going to be 2 months from now.
And I can tell you right now, the fire department's rate of calls,
it's right through the roof.
Is through the roof. Last year they were up by 12%, and I know they're up even higher than last year.
They
so
are.
Over the past couple of years, and they're still working on with the default budget. They're working on last year's money.
Other comments, Mrs. Wolseley?
There's no impediment to Fred coming to us asking for permission to overspend in line areas, particularly in the public works budget. In addition, of our, let's see, 26,507,096 grand operating budget, we still have 16,675,246 at the end of May.
Mm-hmm.
I would rather see case by case, and certainly if we're having to overexpend, I want to see where the overexpends go, and I know the Budget Committee likes to see where you're overspending as well. And whatever revenue comes in will come in, and as Christy pointed out in here, for example, just the motor vehicle revenue came in way over target. So we'll still be getting revenues in over the year. The other factor to be considered here, gentlemen, is that this can't be done at all without the permission of the Municipal Budget Committee.
That's not correct.
It is not?
No.
They don't have to put
no,
their foot in?
No, they do not.
Oh, my goodness.
In a case where the money has already been expended, the statute specifically says under subsection 2 of that statute that the selectmen shall appeal directly to the Commissioner of Revenue.
Okay, I'm looking at 3211 right now that you provided.
Roman 2.
Roman 2?
I believe it's Roman 2.
The Commissioner of Revenue Admin or the Commissioner of Education may accept and approve an application after an expenditure?
Correct.
After an expenditure?
And we've expended
all
it
right,
already.
All right, then. Yeah. And so you're saying that the storm situation in January and February
right.
is post, if caused by a sudden or unexpected emergency, in which case paragraph 1 shall not apply.
Mr. Chairman, there's a motion and a second. Last comment,
yeah.
Please, is that the bean counting's great. The money's been spent. It was an extraordinary storm. We just billeted an experienced new fire chief. We have new command elements in our major bull departments, and I know the board wants them concentrating on operational challenge, not counting beans and what we're going to be cutting. Any surplus of this motion will revert back to surplus, as I understand the comment tonight. So the fiscal issues are moot. And I would ask for the vote.
Okay. And who was the second? Is there a second?
I'll second.
First by Mr. Bean, second by Mr. Waddell. All those in favor, 4-1. And moving on to warranty deed for conservation restriction acceptance to Conservation Commission from Eversource Energy off Timber Swamp Substation, tax map 999-41. Mr. Welch.
That's a mouthful, Mr. Chairman. This is something the Conservation Commission has been working on for 4 or 5 years now. It's a piece of wetland, a very large piece of wetland, that's owned by used to be Public Service Company in New Hampshire. Now it's Eversource or Evergreen or whatever it is. Eversource Energy. They have given a restricted easement to the Conservation Commission over a very large piece of land that they own. And in order for the Conservation Commission to legally accept that, this commission, this board, has to authorize and approve that acceptance. And I would recommend that you do so. This is all wetland. There's nothing out there that's going to be used for anything except breeding mosquitoes.
Or houseboats.
No, it's not that way. If it was, we could make a lot of money.
I make a motion that we accept the warranty.
I'll second, yeah.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Number seven, collection of refuse waste on Little Litchfield Drive, private road. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, we had an application from the developer in this particular case. We don't have an objection to doing that, provided there is no construction ongoing at the time collection takes place. We would make the note that accepting the street, and this is not an accepted public highway at the current time, would be delayed until the road has gone through at least two freeze-thaw cycles to determine that the road will uphold for the required 15 years. This is a private. This is private property, so they're asking us to go on private property.
I'll wait for the
questions. Mr. Bridle,
how does this relate as to other private property that
we've
gone?
We've done this before on appeal to the board, where a subdivision is has been partially built and the road is in place, but has not gone through a two-year freeze-thaw cycle.
Would this be like Stone? I mean, it's up on Exeter Road, where we're having, we haven't had that development.
Stowcroft.
Because that's not, technically that hasn't been turned over to us either, right?
No, it hasn't, but that's a lot more than 2 years.
Right. Yeah. That's a lot more
this
than 2 years.
This is a brand new road.
Right.
That was more like two or three decades, but
right.
Maybe more.
So we have some history with doing this with other private roads?
We have. It does save us from having to take care of a huge mess at the end of the street, because everybody's required to bring their trash to the end of the road in the proper receptacle so that we can pick it up. And that usually ends up with this huge lineup on a public highway.
How about, I'm thinking about the other one down on Verna Way.
What's that?
Off of...
both of those are conditioned because of deed restrictions.
They're conditioned because of deed restrictions.
They have to take care of their own waste.
All right. This is going to be a public road eventually? Is that what we're...
This was planned by the planning board to be a public highway. If you don't accept it, the service would stop.
Unless they brought it up to the end.
That's correct.
I make a motion that we go with this.
Second.
I am opposed. Is there a homeowners association here?
There is. Yeah.
And what does the planning board stipulate?
No, they did not stipulate they had to take care of trash.
Stipulated. Oh, that's wonderful. I love when they do that.
Yeah.
Now, you know.
We have some where they have, and we're still collecting it, even though the information was never given to us after the planning board had, in fact, approved not collecting.
These messes can't continue, and we have gotten ourselves in hot water in the past by just automatically, because so-and-so on the street asked you to go and collect the trash, and so we got stuck doing it. Same thing with the snow plowing. I object to this. Dunvegan Woods, and there's another instance of the planning board where Hampton Meadows was required by the plan to get rid of their own waste, mm-hmm. whereas Dunvegan Woods never had that stipulation. The only thing that's saving us is that there's so much waste, because there are so many units in there, that the people don't want to truck them all out onto High Street, or you'd see something a mile long out on High Street. But large or small, I absolutely object to doing this. And what did you say, Fred? We should wait till for 2 years to see whether we designated a private road or a regular public highway?
Policy in the past has been that we wait through two freeze-thaw cycles mm-hmm. to determine the road will hold up.
Because I don't think it's fair for individuals who have been restricted by the planning board and by deed to not have their pickup, and then to go ahead in a situation like this, and just because people want you to drive in there. I absolutely do not approve of doing any of this. Not here, not ever.
We have a first, we have a second. And I would just like to say that it's been done for other people, and that's part of the problem. When something's done for one, it needs to be done for others.
It doesn't need to be done, but, it has been done.
You don't want to be fair to everyone. I understand
that.
Oh,
that's terrible.
So
I know.
We have a first, we have a second. All those in favor, 4-1.
Bad.
moving on to request of Hampton Falls Selectmen to support emergency turn around on I-95 for emergency vehicles.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, excuse me. I had a telephone call from the town administrator in Hampton Falls asking if the selectmen would support the state creating a turnaround on Interstate 95, or a crossover, I should say, on Interstate 95, after they finish the work on the Taylor River Bridge. Mm-hmm. They're going to construct some alternate roadways so that they can move traffic from one barrel to another barrel as they do the construction. And the thought in Hampton Falls was, when they finish that, could they pave one end of it so there's a crossover? It will save equipment running all the way down to the toll booth and all the way back up the other side of the road, or vice versa, in order to get to an accident. That's a pretty long stretch between crossovers from the toll booth all the way down to the Seabrook Town line. And it's a problem for not only Northampton, but it's a problem for us. So they requested the selectmen's support to ask the state to, in fact, put a crossover at that location when the bridge is finished.
Mr. Chairman, Mr.
I'll make a motion that we support Hampton Falls to petition the state to put that crossover in. I mean, I've driven that road many times in response vehicles. For us to go down to go to the south or the northbound liquor store, we either have to go over to Hampton Falls and get on in Hampton Falls, or we have to get on in Hampton, go all the way down to almost the Seabrook Town line to turn around and come back. Yeah. So this is going to cut probably 2 or 3 minutes of response time for us to get to that northbound liquor store. So I'll make the motion that we support Hampton Falls in their bid to get the crossover.
I'm seconding Rusty. As well, this we're providing free emergency service to the state of New Hampshire on its highway, so they can at least give us this. Well,
true.
Mr. Bean.
No comment, sir.
Mr. Waddell. All those in favor? Unanimous. Any other new business?
Do we have to have a non-public tonight on the goals we talked about for contract?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So
if you want to talk about them tonight, you do.
Right. And I think
Mark
we did.
Is Mark here? Or
is Mark still here?
We really don't need him.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't think you need him.
All right.
I just have one quick thing, because I went to the presentation by the New Hampshire Fiscal Policy Institute last week, on June 2nd, actually. And they've put together, you can get them at, let's see, fpi.org, and they have made a presentation on the state budget, and it's really scary. And on page 11, it shows the impact of backloaded business tax cuts balloons in future years, and it is really scary. I'll get this. I'll make copies for all of you and put them in your
state
slots.
State budget's not, it's in conference, committee of conference.
But
it's
this
not,
is the business tax cuts.
State budget hasn't been passed yet.
It's not going to happen.
I think we should
well, it's projected
it,
through fiscal year 21. Well, if you don't want to do it, I just want you to know that that looks pretty scary to me.
Okay. Mr. Bean?
Negative, sir.
Mr. Waddell?
No, it's all set.
Okay.
I'll make a motion that we go into non-public under RSA 91A.
colon 3.
Subsection.
Wait a second. We'll do it right. We'll do it right.
Max.
Hey, thanks.
The all those. So we're going to be doing that.
Yeah.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 You might want these.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I was going to ask.
I was going to say.
Thank you, yeah.
Okay.
No.
Okay, makes it easy.
Maxis, you got a club named after you, kid.
I know, I did, yeah.
Did someone want to make a motion?
91A3, Roman 2.
Okay.
A.
Yeah.
All right.
Compensation.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye. Thank you.
Good night, Max.
Oh, yeah.